Hasali Fulgati Dho. Lord Jesus, make us worthy to celebrate the exaltation of your glorious cross with sacred hymns and songs. When you appear on the last day, and the sign of your cross will shine brighter than the sun, gather us before you and surround us with your eternal light, that we may raise glory and thanks to you, to your Father, and to your Holy Spirit forever.
Forever. Amen.
Jesus Christ, our Lord, accept these prayers in the fragrance of this incense that we have offered on the feast of the exaltation of your holy cross. May its sign always be visible before our eyes to strengthen us, that we may walk with you toward death, and then stand at your right hand to celebrate the feast of your eternal victory. We glorify you, your Father, and your Holy Spirit, forever.
Praise be to God always.
goodness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved is the power of God.
Alleluia.
Glory and honor to the most holy Trinity. We burn this incense. Kyrie eleison. For the proclamation of the gospel of our Savior. Announcing life for our souls, we offer this incense and ask for your mercy, O Lord. Peace be with you.
And with your spirit.
From the Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to St. Mark, who proclaimed life to the world, let us listen to the proclamation of life and salvation for our souls.
Remain silent, O listeners, for the Holy Gospel is about to be proclaimed to you. Listen and give glory and thanks to the Word of the living God.
The evangelist Mark writes, "Then James and John, the sons of Zebedee, came to Jesus and said to him, 'Teacher, we want you to do for us whatever we ask of you.' He replied, 'What do you wish me to do for you?' They answered him, 'Grant that in your glory we may sit one at your right and the other at your left.' Jesus said to them, 'You do not know what you are asking. Can you drink the cup that I drink, or be baptized with the baptism with which I am baptized?' They said to him, 'We can.' Jesus said to them, 'The cup that I drink, you will drink, and the baptism with which I am baptized, you will be baptized. But to sit at my right or at my left is not mine to give, but is for those for whom it has been prepared.' When the ten heard of this, they became indignant at James and John. Jesus summoned them and said to them, 'You know that those who are recognized as rulers over the Gentiles lord it over them, and their great ones make their authority over them felt. But it shall not be so among you. Rather, whoever wishes to be great among you will be your servant. Whoever wishes to be the first among you will be the slave of all. For the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many.' This is the truth. Peace be with you."
Teacher, we wish that you do whatever we ask you to do. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen." This is a pretty audacious request by these two young men who are certainly not even probably out of their 20s, perhaps in their early 30s, about the age of our Lord. But James and John, because in the parallel gospel, this same episode is recorded as having their mother request this. So their mother's alive. And being a good Mediterranean mom, she wants to make sure that her boys have the best positions and the best food and the best everything. So these young men are probably just in their late 20s. And coming up to our Lord, and they've been with him now for 3 years. So what are they doing? They're finagling to try to make sure they're going to be the first places. And the reason for this is because in the context of this gospel, our Lord has just announced that we're going to go to Jerusalem, And there the Son of Man is going to be betrayed. He will be handed over to the Gentiles, crucified, spit upon, put to death, and on the third day he'll rise again. So being the good men, typical human beings they are, they're thinking, well, this may be coming to an end, but we believe something is happening on this kingdom. And we want to make sure that we have the first positions in it. That's why following this prophecy, they approach him and they say to him, Teacher, Rabbi, we'd like you to do something for us. And that's when he asks the question, then what can I do for you? Well, we want to be on your right and on your left, the first two positions in your kingdom. It's a very human request. This is kind of in the sense of putting it in the 21st century. This is a start that we believe is going to be successful, and we want our initial investment to bring a millionfold back. So these men are looking out for themselves, what they're doing. They're very human, and this is what they're looking at. They're enthusiastic for this rabbi, for the Messiah from Nazareth. And that's why our Lord just asked them the question, can you drink from the cup which is mine? Can you be baptized? This very mysterious phrase, can you be baptized with the baptism with which I am to be baptized? Now we think of baptism, we think of the sacred mystery. But baptism, baptizein in Greek means to plunge or to submerge something. It's the idea of washing. It's why that word, baptisma, has become the word for that sacred mystery that cleanses us of sin. And of course, in the Syriac tradition, we actually did plunge you into the water. But what our Lord is referring to is his sacred passion, the work of redemption. And essentially what this question about his baptism is asking James and John, these two young brothers, is can you be submerged in this betrayal and death and crucifixion in Jerusalem? The baptism with which I am to be baptized. And of course, being young 20-somethings, they say, yep, we can. We can do it. They have no idea what that means. Thanks be to God that at 27 we don't usually know what that means, otherwise we wouldn't do the many things we do do, that we work out and straighten out in our 30s until we can finally get to a cruising altitude at 40. Now, that enthusiasm, we clearly know that they don't understand what he's saying. This is going to be the same cup that our Lord is going to say shortly after this in the Garden of Gethsemane, that this chalice, that this cup could pass by me if it were possible. And then he says to them, my cup you will drink from. And remember that James is going to be the first of the 12 apostles to be martyred. You will drink from my cup, and you will be baptized with the baptism with which I am baptized. You will be submerged in this. But to give you the perks, the positions in heaven, in the kingdom of God, of first and second, that is for those for whom it has been prepared. So he promises them nothing on their human grasping, their desire to hang on to something and to have a position ultimately of authority. They want to be number one and number two with our Lord. They want to be part of that directing committee, so to speak, of whatever this kingdom is going to be. Now, so our Lord doesn't do whatever they wish, but he does part of it. And by saying, you will be part with me in what I am to accomplish, St. Mark then tells us that the other 10 apostles, they're indignant. Because certainly, some of the other apostles, at least some of them, if not most of them, are older than these two young men. And you can think of Simon Peter himself. He said, I have been promised the keys of the kingdom. Who are these two young upstarts coming in and kind of elbowing their way in front of all the rest of us? So St. Mark tells us they're indignant. So you can see our Lord kind of looking at all 12 of these men who have been with him for 3 years. He has been teaching them. And you can imagine this kind of sigh of somewhat of disappointment in human nature, but calling all 12 of them together and saying, look, you know how authority works among the pagan peoples. And authority, it's the motorcades and the bodyguards and the band. You have all of the
these trappings. And because you surround them with all this trapping and hoopla, they think that they're very important to the rest of the community. And they forget that they also are members of the community. And St. Mark then records our Lord saying, and they lorded over them as if they were superior to the rest. But this vision of authority cannot be yours. This is not the way authority is exercised. And so it's why he gives that famous teaching saying that the one who really wants to be number one or number two, they have to become the servant of everyone else. And he says the one who wants to be number one has to become a slave. Now, a lot of times when you read the modern translations, they're very hesitant at using this word slave. But all of the prophecies in the Old Testament that refer to the coming of the Messiah call him a slave. Call him the slave of God. But what is a slave? The reason why we hesitate on this word in the end of the 19th, beginning of 20th century is because we have all of this cultural baggage on the word slave. We say slave, and what we think of is the one famous black and white photo of the scars on the back of this black man. But there have been white slaves, there have been black slaves, there have been Asian slaves. What is the basis of the slavery is the idea of dependence. We strip away the idea of the injustice that's involved with it at times. The basic notion of slavery is that I work, and then reciprocally, you owe to take care, to house, etc. That's why the serfs were in the Middle Ages. Be that as it may, the idea is this complete dependence. The notion of slavery, not being beaten, not being chained up, not being stripped naked. It's the notion of dependence which are in the prophecies. And that's what our Lord means here. You must understand that it's not as among the pagans, who each one tries to look out for numero uno, trying to be top dog, grasping and griming and scratching their way to the top, so to speak. He says, that's not the way you are to be. But authority, you have to understand that you are, by the sacred mystery of your baptism, you are interrelated to one another and codependent. And first of all, you are dependent upon God in absolute sense. Therefore, you are slaves of God. It's the principal title of the Pope, Servus Servorum Dei, which literally means the slave of the slaves of God. That is the Pope's title to this day. And so it's a notion not of being abject and being beaten up, but of being dependent. And we realize there's an interrelation between all of us. And he says if you want to be number one in the community, then realize that dependence to its fullest. And then he finishes by saying, because the Son of Man, I myself, have entered this world not to be served, but to serve and to give my life as a ransom for many. So it's a very beautiful gospel, and it's why it's chosen for this Sunday of the Exaltation of the Cross. Because that cross, of all of its generic term, of whether it's physical ailments, psychological difficulties, emotional problems, all of these crosses help strip away ultimately our arrogance. The word arrogance literally means to pull in or to request to yourself. You draw everything to yourself. Ad rogare. In Latin, rogare means to ask or to petition. And so ad rogare means that you're pulling, you're bringing these things to yourself. So that arrogance, of course, makes us feel independent. Those moments when we have the flu, and we are volcanically erupting from every opening in our body and laying there looking at the ceiling, not being able to think. Those are moments to understand the strength of human nature. Not the wedding eve afternoon when you get all gussied up, you look great, you bought a magnificent dress, fantastic suit, and you go to the wedding. Those are not the moments in which we understand the truth of human nature. We've covered it in cloth and soap and cologne. Our Lord is saying, you will be signs, you have to, the cross will teach you something, but you must go beyond it as a realization of what the gospel is teaching you of this mutual interdependence among yourselves, so that you give of yourself as others give to you, and this is the mutual love, ultimately what we call the body of Christ, the church. So I want to finish with a prayer that we use on the morning of the Exaltation of the Holy Cross from last Thursday. It's part of the divine office that all the priests, and the religious, and the other ministers of the church recite, sing each day. O Christ our Lord, your cross has appeared resplendent in the sky. What the beginning of the prayer does is it gives the historical vision of Constantine in 313. Your cross has appeared resplendent in the sky, and it will appear again at the end of time. Our Lord prophesies the sign of the Son of Man to be seen. So we have the beginning of the conversion of the Roman Empire in the 4th century, and we have the end of time on the Day of Judgment given to us in this prayer. And it will appear again at the end of time, when you will return to judge the universe with justice. So what does this mean for us then? May it appear today over us, and shine its light into our hearts and our spirits, so that we shall see your glory here and now, not in the 4th century, not on the Day of Judgment, but the light of the cross radiate into us at this point, and that we come to desire to encounter you carrying your cross, the stations as we follow our Lord with his cross. But you'll notice when we finish with this prayer that we see our Lord passing by, and our desire is to take up our cross and to follow him, as he tells us we must do with the gospel. So that our desire to encounter you carrying your cross, we shall enter into the procession of light to praise you forever. So that by picking up our cross and carrying it behind our Lord, this procession is not the bloody one of Calvary, but is transformed into one of light, into the praise of the divine kingdom. May God grant us this light. May God grant us the strength and the light that shines in our hearts and our minds, so that we may carry our cross and be blessed and transformed by this divine love of the light of the Exaltation of the cross. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. Proceed to the blessing in the procession with the Holy Cross for the Feast of the Exaltation. So choir, we're on page 6 to do the colo on page 6. You have that? By the cross, the walls of death were overthrown,
and the righteous were set free from its dark realm. By the cross we can approach the tree of life, for the gates of paradise are open now. We take refuge in your cross, O Lord our God, and we bless ourselves with it throughout the day. May it guard your flock from harm and keep her safe. For it guards us from the one who tempts us all. Glory and honor of the Most Holy Trinity, we burn this incense. Kyrie eleison. May we be worthy to praise, glorify, glory, thanksgiving, worship, honor, praise, exaltation, greatness, and beauty to the Savior, who by his cross concluded the mysteries of the prophets and completed the parables of the seers. He confirmed the types of the foreshadowers and fulfilled the images of the ancients. He made the speech of the preachers glorious, gave the word with power to the evangelists, and they proclaimed his gospel in the four corners and gathered the peoples and nations for his dominical worship. The good one is due glory and honor of this time and in all the feasts, moments, hours, seasons, and days of our lives, now in all ages, forever.
Amen.
Today we celebrate the memorial of the feast of the salvific, precious, and holy cross by which the veil of evil was torn up and shredded. By it all things passed away and were fulfilled, and everything became new by it. By it the death of the transgression of the commandment was repaid. The host of the adversary was scattered, and hope dawned upon the faithful by the sign of the salvific and life-giving cross. The cross, the cause of blessings, the cross, the sign of victory, the cross, the principle of dogmas, the cross, the hope of believers, the cross, the strengthener of Christians, the cross, the fount of life, the cross, the intercessor of blessings, the cross, the key of paradise, the cross, the slayer of the serpent, the cross, the crusher of the head of the dragon, the cross, the destroyer of sin, the cross, the banisher of death, the cross, the crusher of all error, the cross, the shame of infidels, the cross, the staff of the human race, the cross, the dissolver of decay, the cross, the light of the world, the cross, the pride of our witness, the cross, the root of our life, the cross, the crown of believers, the cross, the foundation of all churches, the cross, the uprooter of Sheol. By the cross, the resurrection dawned upon us. By the cross, the enemy was defeated. By the cross, we were restored to paradise. The cross, the rampart of life. The cross, the rafter of our altars. The cross, the armor in battle. The cross, the sign of tranquility and reconciliation. The cross, the icon of the Word of God. The cross, the pledge of inheritance. The cross, the confidence of all the prophets. The cross, the honor of the apostles. The cross, the teachings of teachers. The cross, the rampart of the Holy Church. The cross, the perfection of love. The cross, the fear of demons. The cross, the staff of wonders, the cross, the palm of parables, the cross, the consummation of all priestly labor. By the cross, our sacrifices are perfected. By the cross, our prayers are sealed. By the cross, our bodies are signed. By the cross, our senses are equipped. By the cross our souls are preserved. The cross is an insurmountable tower. The cross is a refuge that cannot be shaken. The cross is an invincible rampart. The cross is our fortified citadel and village of escape. The cross is our protection, our house of refuge, and the cause of all our blessings. We celebrate this today, for it is binding of our image, is found in the rust of our sins, is polished off. Our oldness is made new, our souls are illumined by God, and we become family members and kinsmen to the Son of the Heavenly Father. To Him who became present in flesh, we petition and ask Him that He let be for us a consoler in distresses, a rescuer in afflictions, a deliverer from temptations, a shelter from persecutors, a healer of illnesses, and a mender and supporter in heartbreaks, a forgiver of all sins, and a giver of relief to the departed believers, that we celebrate the feast of His dispensation today. May we be worthy of the place above, and raise glory to Him, and to His Father, and to His Holy Spirit, now and all times, forever. Saved us, Jesus Christ, our Lord and God, and it gave us life now on this day. In all the lands, the church bows down and adores your cross, and your children sing praise. By your death on the cross, you have saved the world. God told Moses, make a serpent out of bronze, raise it up on high. When those bitten by the serpents see this sign, they will not taste death. Moses did as God said. This foreshadowed the cross that gives life to all. Through the ages, kings and rulers of the world and the Church of Faith humbly bowed down to adore the cross of Christ, who is King and Judge. Holy life-giving cross, grant the world unity. Lord, we give you thanks. In the arms of your cross, O Lord, shelter your destitute people and shine its light on the faces of our departed believers. May we and they stand at your right hand in great glory and honor to you, and to your Father and to your Holy Spirit, now and at all times, forever. In your cross we take refuge, Jesus Christ our Lord and God. By your cross you have saved us, we adore it all times.
Lord, your cross conquered Satan, blessed be your
page 10.
Life was hung before us that
that we should not fear the encounters of the night or the daytime arrows at the noontime of passions, which are shot at us by the adversary. For you are our mighty refuge, and we worship you and give you thanks now and at all times forever.
Amen.
The church, your betrothed, boasts in you, and she and her children are sealed by your living mark. She is rescued by you from the evil one, her enemy. She honors the arms of the champion of her people, and she receives total victory through you. She cries out to you who were crucified and says, Lord, forgive your people and do not turn away from your inheritance. Let us cry out and say three times, Kyrie eleison. Paul and Peter, all apostles, on this day sing God's praises, for all nations were converted when you taught them gospel. They give honor and raise glory to the cross of their Savior. As they praise it with the angels, they sing hymns and rejoicing. They cry out today in faith, grant your mercy, Lord, we pray. Savior of the afflicted, finder of the lost, raiser of the fallen, raise us up, O Lord, from the fall of our sin and loose us from the fetters of evil deeds. May your cross be a guardian of our souls against the evil one, and his host, for our hope is in you. And we call to you, our Lord and our God, to you be glory forever.
Amen.
In the typology of the cross of light, Moses divided the sea for the Israelite people, and as a symbol of it, he held a bronze serpent for the healing of the bites of snakes. By the stretching forth of his hands, he defeated Amalek and his hosts. Grant us, O Lord, that we may defeat the height which rises against the church, which was ransomed by your cross. Let us humbly call out to you, forgive, and have mercy on us as we cry out three times. Let us cry out and three times proclaim, This water will be available to you today, of course, and also next week we'll leave the holy water here. You can bring recipients, bottles, and more. Now we have a ceremony of the aspersion of the water, reminding of us of our baptism, calling the mercy of the light of the cross upon our souls. So if you'd like to begin, cleanse me with this soul, and I shall be pure. Wash me and I shall be whiter than snow.
Up and I shall be pure. Wash me and I shall be whiter than snow, and whiter than snow. Cleanse me with hyssop and I shall be pure. Wash me and I shall be whiter than snow.
Whiter than snow.
Cleanse me with hyssop and I shall be pure. Wash me and I shall be whiter than snow.
Whiter than snow.
Cleanse me with hyssop and I shall be pure.
Spare us from the ravages of war and hunger, and from every man-made and natural disaster. Protect the faithful inhabitants of this city, and send your power to sustain and strengthen them through this water. Answer our petitions, have mercy on your people, and save your inheritance. For you are gracious and the lover of mankind. O Lord our God, to you be glory, now and forever. We believe in one God, Father Almighty,
maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial of the Father. Through him all things were created. Thus men for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary, and became man. For our sake he was crucified and upon his side. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord of the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. And we look forward to the resurrection of the dead and life of the world to come. Amen.
Our Lord, God.
these offerings that your children have brought to you out of their love for you and for your holy name. Shower your spiritual blessings upon them, and in place of their earthly gifts, grant them life and your kingdom. His plan of salvation for us. We recall upon this offering all those who have pleased God from Adam to this day, especially Mary, the Blessed Mother of God, Saint Joseph, her spouse, Saint Mary, Saint Jude, and Saint Charbel. Remember, O God, the children of the Holy Church, our fathers and mothers, and our brothers and sisters, both the living and the departed. Especially those from the sacrifices offered for the repose of Mary and Maroon. Remember also all those who share with us today in this offering.
Days of our lives through the grace of your only Son and for love for all people. We glorify. glorify and honor you, your only Son and your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Holy God and Father, you sent your only Son to save us, for we are weak and poor. When we went astray, he brought us back to your spiritual fold by his royal blood. Through your grace and the favor of your only Son, we implore you to accept this bloodless sacrifice from our sinful hands, and through it to forgive our sins. We glorify and honor you, your only Son, and your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Lord God, the Father, and the grace of the only begotten Son, and the communion and indwelling of the Holy Spirit, be with you, my brothers and sisters, forever.
We await your second coming.
ascension, birth, and baptism, your saving passion, and your life-giving death, your burial, your glorious resurrection, and your ascension into heaven, your sitting at the right hand of God the Father, and your royal second coming, when you will judge all people and reward them according to their deeds. Now we ask you, at that fearful hour, have compassion on us and have mercy on us in your kindness, and forgive our sins in your mercy. For this your church implores you, and through you and with you implores your Father, saying,
have mercy on us, Almighty Father, have mercy on us.
O glorious, be your sinful children, receive your graces, we thank you for them and because of them.
We praise you, we bless you, we adore you, we glorify you, we profess our faith in you, and we ask you, have compassion on us, have mercy on us, and hear us.
How awesome is this form, my beloved, for the living Holy Spirit descends and rests upon this offering for our sanctification. Let us stand with reverence as we pray.
Animorio, 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 nite moro, hoyo codisho, una fea loinuo corbuno.
Remember, O Lord, upon this altar and upon On your heavenly altar, the Holy and Ever-Virgin Mary, Mother of God, the prophets, apostles, martyrs, confessors, and evangelists, John the Baptist, the forerunner, Stephen the archdeacon and first martyr, St. Joseph, St. Jude, St. Marin, and St. Charbel, and all the saints, may we join in their ranks and share in their heavenly feast. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, the faithful teachers who have gone to their rest in the true faith, especially Peter, Paul, Mark, Clement, Ignatius, Dionysus, Julius, and all those who endured suffering and persecution for the strengthening of your holy church. Remember also those who serve your holy altar and forgive their sins, that they may reach your joyful dwellings. We pray to you, O Lord.
We hope to find mercy and forgiveness for our sins and for theirs.
Grant us, O God, to the fire, and forgive the sins we have committed, with or without our knowledge.
Grant us pardon, O God, and forgive us and the departed, so that your blessed name may be glorified in us and in all things. With the name of our Lord Jesus Christ and of your living Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Peace be with you.
receive a blessing from the Lord.
O Lord, look upon us, your inheritance who bow before you, and guide our steps on your right path. Make us worthy to share in this sacrifice, and may it sanctify the souls and bodies of those who receive it. Through Christ Jesus our Lord, we glorify and honor you, your only Son and your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
The grace of the Most Holy Trinity, eternal and consubstantial, be with you, my brothers and sisters, forever.
Let each one of us look to God with reverence and humility and ask Him for mercy and compassion.
Holy gifts for the holy with perfection, purity, and sanctity. One Holy Father,
one Holy Son, one Holy Spirit. Blessed be the name of the Lord, for He is one in heaven and on earth. To Him be glory forever.
May us worthy of the Lord God,
so that our bodies may be sanctified by your holy body, and our souls purified by your forgiving blood. May our communion be for the forgiveness of our sins and for your life.
There is a second collection for our victims in Florida.
Again and again we thank you, O Lord, and raise glory to you, giving us your body to eat and your living blood to drink. O Lover of all people, have mercy on us.
Mercy
on us, O Lord.
divine gift and has made us worthy to share in the body and blood of your only begotten Son to save us. Through him and with him, glory and honor are due to you and to your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Peace be with you.
And with your spirit.
Jesus Christ, our Lord and God, you are worshipped and you are holy. Bless and forgive the priests who are the stewards of your people and of your holy church. Forgive the servants of your divine mysteries and all the faithful who shared in his sacrifice. Care for orphans, help widows, assist the poor and the distressed. Satisfy the hungry and protect all who call upon your holy name in every place. May your name be glorified of that of your Father and of your Holy Spirit, who is good, life-giving, and consubstantial with you now and forever.
Amen.
Go in peace, my beloved brothers and sisters, with the nourishment and the blessings that you have received from the forgiving altar of the Lord. May the blessing of the Most Holy Trinity accompany you, the Father and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, the